Mr. Danielson will be filming us today. So thank you for being here, Bruce.
And we've got Mark Winegar and Doug Kronaizl. I told you I was going to screw it up. They've started, been involved with a new group called Represent South Dakota. And if you read the Argus cannot write anything about them unless they say, this is a group that was started by a Massachusetts group. Which I always find interesting because they never say all those Republicans are from a Kansas group called the Cone Brothers, but they got to stay in Massachusetts. So they're not. They're a South Dakota group, and they're here to tell you what they're up to. So, Mark,
all right, turn over to you. Thank you. But before you run away, sign me up.
Write
down the numbers. Okay, well, I am Mark Winegar, and there really is not a leader of Represent South Dakota, although I'm often referred to as the leader. We are a fully democratic group, and we forgot one person. Stand up, Nick. Nicholas Rasmussen and I were asked to do this, and we were looking for other people, and I mentioned, I know this kid that graduated from Columbia, started an initiative called Respect the Vote in his senior year, came out here and worked his tail off to get it on the ballot, and I said, we've got to get him. So he's the only one that actually gets paid. So maybe he's a leader.
Nope.
So anyway,
well, and you should make sure to clarify that Represent South Dakota is fully democratic in that we are encompassing all people from all walks of life, all stripes, all voters, Democrats, Republicans. I mean, when you think about IM22, it wouldn't have passed were it not for a nonpartisan support across the entire political spectrum of people who are fed up seeing this going on up here. So that's what the group is made up of as well here on the ground.
Absolutely. I think everybody knows I'm a Democrat, and but this is a nonpartisan initiative. So we've got a lot of things going on. We've got marches going on. We also have a march, a women's march in Vermilion, on the 21st. For those of you from Vermilion, we will meet at United Church of Christ at, I believe it's 10:30 in the morning, but it's online, so double check that time. Our walk is going to be from Dakota Street down to the courthouse and back. We'll end up back at UCC for fellowship, warm coffee, and I'm sure that there'll be some treats there. I didn't organize that one, but we'll have it there. So how did we get Represent South Dakota? A lot of people over... A lot of people over a very long period of time were dissatisfied with government performance. Now, I'm sure that there are some of you in here that have some concerns, some things where you think our state government or our federal government has let us down. Am I right? You know, one of the areas is, you know, we just haven't done anything about cost of health care. We got the ACA, or what people like to call Obamacare, but we haven't done anything with the pharmacies. We haven't done anything with the medical equipment companies. Why?
Lobbyists.
Uh-oh. I just became a lobbyist this week. You know, everybody has these issues. And what I found running for office in District 17 is people will share those with you. And you want to do something about it, but your hands are tied. And we want to untie those hands by getting rid of the bad money in politics. So why aren't we getting the service we need and deserve?
Go ahead. We'll let Doug take over.
Well, we have a video here, but issues with Midco might keep us from being able to play it. So I'm going to hold this speaker up, this microphone up to the speaker, and hopefully that'll blast it loud out of these for you. Hopefully it'll play, or else we can just describe what we got going on here. So,
for the last few years, I've had this sense that everything I learned as a kid about how America's government works is completely wrong. But I had no idea how bad things actually were until I saw this one graph. Researchers at Princeton University looked at more than 20 years worth of data to answer a pretty simple question: does the government represent the people? Now, this is what they found. This axis here represents public support for any given idea. On the left, at 0%, are ideas that not a single American wants. On the right, at 100%, are ideas that everyone supports. This axis represents the likelihood of Congress passing a law that reflects any of these ideas, from a 0 to a 100% chance. On this graph, an ideal republic would look like this. If 50% of the public supports an idea, there's a 50% chance of it becoming law. If 80% of us support something, there's an 80% chance. You get the idea. Now, most Americans would probably agree that, with a few exceptions, we should be as close to this ideal as possible. Unfortunately, the way America actually works doesn't even come close. Take an idea that nobody supports, literally nobody, and it has about a 30% chance of becoming federal law. Now, take an incredibly popular idea, the most popular idea this country has ever seen, and there's also about a 30% chance of it becoming law. This means that the number of American voters for or against any idea has no impact on the likelihood that Congress will make it law. Put another way, and I'm just going to quote the Princeton study directly here, the preferences of the average American appear to have only a minuscule, near zero, statistically non-significant impact upon public policy. So if you've ever felt like your opinion doesn't matter and that the government doesn't really care what you think, well, you're right. But there's a catch. This flat line only accounts for the bottom 90% of income earners in America. Economic elites, business interests, people who can afford lobbyists, they get their own line. Look at how much closer their line is to the ideal. When they want something, the government is much more likely to do it. And when they don't, they have the power to completely block it from happening, no matter how much the rest of the country supports it. They get what they want, and guess who ends up paying for it? We pay for it with the most expensive healthcare in the world. We pay for it with a tax code that's a complete mess. We pay for it with internet that's slower and more expensive, with wasteful spending, a floundering education system, a catastrophic drug war, and 1 in 5 American children born into poverty. Almost every major issue we face as a nation can be traced back to this graph. How does this happen? Well, just follow the money. Right now, it's perfectly legal to buy political influence in America. Here's how it works. Let's say a big bank wants a law that would force taxpayers to bail them out again if they repeat the exact same reckless behavior that crashed the global economy in 2008. Not exactly the most popular idea with the public, and Congress knows that. That should be the end of it. But that's where the money comes in. It's perfectly legal for our bank to hire a team of lobbyists, whose entire job is to make sure that the government gives the bank what it wants. Then, those lobbyists can track down members of Congress who regulate banks and help raise a ton of money for their re-election campaigns. It's perfectly legal for those lobbyists to offer those same politicians million-dollar jobs at their lobbying firm. Then, those lobbyists can literally write the language of this new bailout law themselves and hand it off to the politician they just buttered up with campaign money and lucrative job offers. And it's perfectly legal for those politicians to take the lobbyist-written language and sneak it through Congress at the last second. So now you've got a law that greatly benefits the banks, and the whole process can start over. This is how a bill becomes a law. A special interest hires some lobbyists, those lobbyists collect campaign contributions, offer jobs, and then write the laws that Congress then passes to help those same special interests. This happens every day on every single issue with politicians of both parties. In the last 5 years alone, the 200 most politically active companies in the United States spent $5.8 billion influencing your government. those same companies got $4.4 trillion in taxpayer support. And that's trillion, with a T. And that's just the top 200 companies. Never mind every other special interest, every union, every trade association, and every billionaire. Every single one of them can use their money to buy political influence. You know, there's this idea out there that this only became a problem after the Supreme Court Citizens United decision in 2010. But the data goes back almost 40 years, and the results are clear. Corruption is legal in America. And as long as it is, anyone who can spend money to buy political influence will. The solution here isn't rocket science. Make corruption illegal. We already know Congress won't do it. I mean, one look at this chart will tell you that. What we need is a plan that lets us go around Congress and do what the American people do best. Fix this mess ourselves. Well, good news. We have that plan and it's already working. Now that we've got the problem covered, let us show you how to be part of the solution.
All right. It worked. I was ready to leave by that. Did not think the internet would cooperate with us. So, yeah, that was a problem that, did you want to speak?
I was just going to say, in the interest of full disclosure, I am a lobbyist for the Sierra Club of South Dakota, and our total budget is $5,000, which doesn't even pay my expenses during the year.
That was the problem. That was the problem we were faced with, and we're talking about how we can fix it. There's another video here, but I think for the sake of time, we could skip forward because, fortunately, in South Dakota, we did fix it, or we tried.
Oh, I would play that. Well.
He lives in an alternative reality.
I think she should be ashamed of herself.
South Dakota voters spoke at the ballot box by passing the so-called Anti-Corruption Act.
I know how bad corruption is. I mean, I used to be president.
All our legislators do is raise money.
It's time to take matters into our own hands.
I'm gonna hug you every day now.
Go to represent.us.
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 There is a movement.
And so, yes, we did fix it with Initiated Measure 22. And those two videos were from represent.us. They existed before Represent South Dakota came about, which is a collection of, like we mentioned before, a bunch of South Dakota volunteers and voters out there on the grounds working to defend Initiated Measure 22. Well, let's zip forward.
Now, if you want to give some hugs, one guy you need to give a big hug to is Rick Weiland. Without Rick, this would not have gotten off the ground.
So, breaking down Initiative Measure 22, what we wanted to do today when talking to you was lay out the background of the issue, sort of what's happening with Initiative Measure 22, answer some of those questions that people had about what's currently going on, and then talking about what Represent Us and Represent South Dakota, more specifically, are doing on the ground to defend the win, get the voice out there, and start organizing people to stand up for the law that we passed. So the good news is, yes, we passed it. We passed Initiated Measure 22 last November. And so I wanted to give you some stats here that we found out. Let's go for this. So we want to go district by district. In South Dakota, overall, the vote was about 52-48%. A majority vote, an initiated measure will pass with a majority vote go into law. But district by district, you see some pretty interesting stats. So District 13, which we are standing in right now, 51% of the voters in District 13 voted in favor of Initiated Measure 22. And I know down in District 17, we were, I think, 55 or something along those lines. But I wanted to point out some of the districts that voted most in favor of it, because it points to a really interesting thing with Initiative Measure 22. The district that 26A, which is down here, it's a Rosebud Reservation, 60% in favor was the second highest. The highest was actually District 15 here in Sioux Falls, where 64% of the voters voted in favor of IM 22. Yes, if you're in District 15, give yourself a hand. But then one of the most interesting facts that I noticed was District 35, which is all the way out here in Rapid City, the other side of the state, 60% of the voters in District 35 voted in favor of IM 22. And that's an interesting fact because, as we know, on the western half of the state, people tend to lean a little bit more conservative. And if you were listening to how IM-22 was portrayed during the election cycle, it was very much portrayed to be tried to paint it as a Democrat ploy. But really, what we see with these stats here is that support for IM-22 really did extend across party lines and really tapped into a lot of voters who felt disenfranchised with how things were going in Pierre, people who were fed up with these scandals and improprieties. I mean, EB5 and Gear Up, these issues, voters saw that and saw thousands, millions of taxpayer dollars being wasted at the state level because we weren't keeping an eye on what was going on in Pierre. There just wasn't a lot of transparency for us as voters to really know what was going on up there. So voters spoke at the ballot box. They spoke with Initiative Measure 22. And to talk about Initiative Measure 22, it did a lot. It was a big, big, long bill. I think 60-something pages or something. 34 pages. Whew. Thank you, Daryl, for helping me out with that one. I wouldn't want to blow anything too far out of the water. 34 pages, did a whole lot, created an independent ethics commission. It created a new revolving door laws. You know, right now you only have to wait 1 year after working for the state or being a legislator before you can go and become a lobbyist. Then we increased it to 2 years, so you have to wait at least one election cycle before you can get back in there and start lobbying after being an elected official. It put gift limits on what lobbyists can give to legislators. I mean, before IM-22 was around, South Dakota had some of the vaguest and almost non-existent laws when it came to that, or describing that and making the standards known. So IM-22 really cemented that right into law. Campaign finance reform created a system whereby voters can opt in and receive funds to give to candidates of their choosing rather than candidates having to rely on donations coming from lobbyists and coming from organizations. And then also set a bunch of limits on what campaigns can raise, who they can raise money from. And then these Sunshine Finance Reports really compelled the Secretary of State's office to make all of this information a lot more accessible to voters, to make it accessible to anyone who is trying to get out there to find out, you know, where's this money coming from, where's this money going. So did a lot, cleaned up a lot, opened up a lot of the government to the rest of the people, which is exactly what we wanted when we went to the polls. Now, I wouldn't have to be sitting here talking, like, the election was last November, so we wouldn't be here talking with you today if everything was said and done. So, of course, we do have the bad news, as I'm sure you're aware. So we decided to put together a little timeline here for everybody to give them a little bit of background. So on November 8th, IM-22 passes. 52% of the vote goes into law. November 23rd, there was a lawsuit filed against IM-22. A group of 24 legislators and a lobbying organization, the Family Heritage Alliance, got together. And I think there were a couple of additional citizens who were listed on the complaint. But that lawsuit is Kurt et al. Versus the state of South Dakota. They decided to sue the state to try to get IM-22 off the books. So here's Kurt of Kurt et al., Senator Blake Kurt. He's in District 12. And I wanted to...
My opponent.
What's that? Oh, there you go. Well, shoot. Yeah, they would have had to put someone else's name on the court title. But interesting fact about District 12 is that the voters in Senator Blake Kurd's district voted 54% in favor of IM-22 at the polls, and then Senator Blake Kurd went and tried to sue it out of existence. The other person leading the charge is Senator Representative Deb Peters. She is out of District 9, also here around the Sioux Falls area. And District 9 voted 56% in favor of IM-22. And now Representative Peters is leading the charge to undo and repeal and sue it out of existence. And then here's the et al. For you. And one of the interesting ones is you saw the 35. Yeah, Mark Willitson. There are a bunch of Mark Mickelson here, I think District 13. You got a lot of people in Sioux Falls who are coming out hard, even though, I mean, let's see here. District 9 was 56%. District 10, 52%. 15, 64%. 14, 52%. 13, 51%. 12, 54%. And then 11, 52%. So the districts in Sioux Falls were very much in favor of IM-22. But a lot of the elected officials out of the area are now leading the charge to really dismantle it and defang it, which is something that we're trying to get out, which we're very happy that we get to speak to a big room of people from around the Sioux Falls area to get that word out to them. So the lawsuit was filed November 23rd. That was about the time when Nicholas and Mark here got started really putting together Represent South Dakota, realized that this wasn't going to be an easy fight. And you know, out in Pierre, they have the benefit of they're all in the same building, the same room, sometimes at the same table. It's a lot easier for them to organize what it is they're going to do. The people don't really have that luxury. The only time when we're really organized saying what it is we want is when we go to the polls. And then when the elected officials choose to ignore what we say at the polls, we're kind of left up the creek. So that's what Represent South Dakota kind of came about doing, was to organize people, find people who were interested, and kind of start getting the word out there, helping people make their voices heard. So that was November 23rd. And then December 6th, we got Dennis Dugard. He gives his budget address. And I'm sure you've heard some of the great quotes that came out of that. The first one was Governor Dugard saying, of IM-22, I am certain voters of the state did not support that. Which is news to me. I thought the clearest indication of what the voters supported is what they say when they go to the polls and vote something into law. But hey, maybe Dennis knows a little bit more than I do. And then the great one, the voters were hoodwinked. We were all hoodwinked into voting for anti-corruption laws and greater transparency in our government. Every last one of us. And this is around the time when you started hearing out of Pierre that they were going to lead the charge to kind of dismantle the bill, despite the fact that it was voted in by the people and despite the fact that that is what the people wanted. Similar to what we saw with initiated Measure 14 back in 2014, not 3 months after that passed, we saw another amendment, the youth minimum wage, which was then referred and soundly defeated, sending a voice to Pierre that, hey, we know what we voted for. We were very much informed. We're aware of what's going on, and this is what we want. Please leave our bills alone. So that was December 9th. December 6th. And then on December 9th, there was an injunction. And this is an important part because I've seen in a lot of different media outlets, people are talking about how IM-22 was declared unconstitutional, which is not true. In December 9th, Circuit Court out of Hughes County, the judge enjoined the law, which stayed it. So it is not currently in effect. I think IM-22 is only in effect from a week after its passage until it was stayed in court. With the injunction, but that is where it stands right now. And I know folks at South Dakotans for Integrity are working on an appeals process and getting it up to a higher court where it can be heard on its merits. And that's where the law stands right now. Is that it's working its way through the legal system, but nobody's come out declaring anything unconstitutional at this point in time. And so the argument that it's been declared unconstitutional, we can repeal it, doesn't really hold any water at the legislative level. And yeah.
Maybe you could mention the judge who made that ruling.
Yes, there is a lot of talk about the judge, Mark Barnett.
Former
Attorney General, former candidate for governor. Hopefully, it'll be heard on its merits when it gets up to the next level through the appeals process. Unfortunately, Represent South Dakota isn't involved in the legal aspect of that, but that's what we've heard from South Dakotans for Integrity. That's where they're at right now in the legal fight. And then January 10th, the session began. Mark and Nicholas and I actually were able to, and Connie here, we actually drove up through the blowing winds and snow and chilly weather to go stand in front of Pier for about half an hour with a lot of supporters who came out on their lunch breaks from Pier. It was cold, but we were trying to send a message out there with a little bit of a rally on the first day that we want you to respect the vote. We want you to respect what the voters voted for. Don't don't go about trying to repeal things that the voters said that they wanted, especially because the fact, the reason this had to happen at the polls, at, through the initiative process, is that we couldn't trust the state government to try to rein itself in. The people had to make these laws. But when you have the state government coming in then, the very people who we were trying to rein in, creating new laws or trying to repeal laws that we said that we wanted, it leaves a bad taste in our mouth, and that's something that we're trying to get out there to them as well. And then this is an older PowerPoint. We didn't update it. Most recently, Secretary of State Chantel Krebs has put out two proposals, Senate Bill 53 and Senate Bill 54. Senate Bill 53, from our point of view, I mean, we were having this conversation down in Vermillion with a group of supporters. It really makes, it takes what we intended to be an independent ethics commission and makes it into a partisan ethics commission, one that is in no way independent. The Secretary of State herself would be on the board, which removes any sort of semblance of independence. Another huge fact about this is that members on the board can be removed by whoever appointed them at moment's notice without cause, which makes it hard to think that anyone's going to be able to be too independent if that's the setup that you have. So that's Senate Bill 53. 54 is campaign finance things. Peels back a lot of the stuff that the voters asked for. For instance, at legislative and county races, there was a $750 cap that was in IM-22 that's now gone. We're afraid that Senate Bill 53 and 54 are going to be pushed through masquerading as a solution to say to the voters, oh no, see, we're passing ethics laws for you and everybody here. But what we're trying to get across is that these are masquerading as solutions. The solution, at the end of the day, the voters wanted what the voters wanted. The voters wanted when they went to the polls and voted for IM-22.
What was that comment about 53 and 54?
I don't know. You go ahead and comment it.
Smoke and mirrors.
Very much so. And the whole idea of, I mean, they've been talking about repeal and replace. For one, smoke and mirrors code word for disrespecting the will of the voters. But for two, when you're repealing something and replacing it, you got to understand what they're repealing is what the voters wanted. And replacing it with what either they think the voters wanted or what the state government wants, which is not at all what we were voting for when we went in and passed IM-22. So that's what's currently happening out in Pier. And then we got a little picture here, initiative measure 22. This was before session started. They've been very upfront. I mean, the governor in his state of the state address not only said that he would support efforts to repeal IM-22, a voter enacted law, but also to reform the initiative and referendum process, which usually means make it harder for grassroots citizens to put things on the ballot through our constitutional initiative referendum process. So, how you can help? How you can be a part of Represent South Dakota? Like I said, right now our goal is just to organize people, organize folks, get the word out there. We are much louder and a much more persuasive voice when we're all speaking together. Unfortunately, they didn't think that when we went to the polls, but we got to show them now that that we did mean what we voted for. That's the will of the people, and we want them to simply respect the will of the people. So, letters to the editor is always great. I mean, there are so many papers around here that will take submissions. I know Mark here has got a little handy list that he uses whenever he has something that he has to ruffle feathers with and send it out to the papers. So, writing letters to the editor always a good way. Attending Cracker Barrels. I think the one in the next one in Sioux Falls is either on the 21st? No, it's February. The first Saturday of February is the Cracker Barrel of the Sioux Falls legislators here. Attending those, that's you face-to-face with the legislators who are out there trying to repeal the will of the people. Though that's the perfect place to make your voice heard for people. And legislative forum. I mean, they're
well, I don't know what a Cracker Barrel is.
Legislative coffee. Yeah,
that's what you call it here.
Yeah. Sorry. We got the Cracker Barrels down in Vermillion, so I should put up all the different ones. Legislative coffee, get-togethers, things like that. Volunteering with Represent South Dakota is always a big. We do some phone banking here and there. We're going to really ramp these efforts up now that they've made pretty clear of what the intention of the legislature is in this. If you have some time to volunteer, Nicholas here, who's with us today, he's been organizing people in the Sioux Falls area, and we've all been keeping in pretty good touch to make sure that we're all moving in one direction, keeping the momentum going, and then also spreading the word, letting other people know what Represent South Dakota is about. We're on Facebook. People can find us there. They can contact Mark, Nicholas, myself. We're gonna have some contact information up on the next page. But yeah, letting people know that we're doing this, that we're all organized together. Really, our goal is to make it so organized that we know exactly where these letters to the editors are going. We know where the phone calls are being made, just so we can make sure that we're keeping the pressure spread evenly out across the entire state and getting the message to every legislator throughout the state. And then also, you can sign up today. We've got sign-up sheets here at the front, and you can feel free to come up and leave contact information, stuff like that. You're not signing up for a mailing list. You're just signing up to be in touch with Mark and myself and Nicholas, and we will keep in touch. We can remind you when Cracker Barrels are happening. We can help you out if you need an email address on where to send a letter to the editor, simple stuff like that. We're just trying, I mean, we got time on our hands, so we're just trying to make it as easy as possible for everyone else to make their voice heard. In whatever way we can help. So, would you like to speak?
Sure.
Speak a word?
Yeah. In closing, there's a whole bunch of people who have been involved in this, like Daryl, who have been doing great work and will continue, but we've got to send a message to the governor to honor the will of the people. That's all we're asking. Is honor the will of the people. So if you're interested, there's bumper stickers, buttons, all kinds of little giveaways up to the front. And if you'd like to be on the mailing list and maybe be more involved, there's the sign-up sheets there.
Mm-hmm.
Any questions?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
That's
okay. Yes.
Like, you know, Samantha, in my organization, will buy legislators lunch. We're not high-powered lobbyists, but how exactly was the law written, and what are those limits?
Well, the limit on a gift is $100 per year, as written. But you have to consider, what is a gift? Is it, you know, is if you're buying lunch for a group of people, does that constitute a gift to an individual? I don't know.
Fortunately, the way the law was written with IM-22, the Ethics Commission was given the power, was supposed to be vested the power to define these things and address these issues, but unfortunately our legislators out in Pierre thought it kind to dismantle that or stay it from going into effect.
Yeah, the key thing here is the Ethics Commission. Yeah, that would be a great question for them. Yeah.
Where can we find the text for this? Oh, Senate Bill 53 and 54.
Well, I believe you can find them out at Dakota Free Press.
I've got links to it, but just go to sdlegislature.gov. You can even bring it up on the screen.
Yeah, well, why don't you?
Sdlegislature.gov. That's the main page for the Legislative Research Council. And up the left-hand corner of the page, you'll see a link for session. You go to 2017, and then you'll click on bills, and there will be a big ugly list of bills. You just look for SB 53 for Senate bill, and SB 54 for Senate bill. That's the other one he's talking about.
It's already in my search history.
Yeah. And I find it a whole lot easier to go out to Dakota Free Press and hit the link. Yeah, Jim.
As one of the largest PAC groups on the left, And I do want to say, on the left, the political center or left, this would have absolutely no bearing on us. Now, for instance, this year we did make contributions to candidates of $1,000. We met the requirement. Under the what the people of the initiative, that would be cut back to $750. As far as we're concerned, That's great, because then we could give more candidates $750. And as far as we buy no one lunch, we give no gifts, and we don't offer of incentives that they can come back after they serve their term, they can come back and get a high paid position in the Democratic Forum. So, as far as we're concerned, this would be a wonderful idea if what the people enacted would actually go through. And it really wouldn't have anything to do with this. It's not like we're going to lower dues or anything.
Now, the key word there that they're all upset about is that word gift. If you look at the definition of gift, it doesn't mean you can't work for a living. You know, some people have said, well, I'm going to have to quit my job because the school district might belong to an association that employs a lobbyist, and that might cause me to have a problem. Well, what's happened, for instance, in the case of an insurance salesman, there's a premium that is paid to the company, not the insurance agent, and they get something in return. There's reciprocity there. It's not a gift. Yeah?
On what grounds do they claim that it's unconstitutional?
Well, I would certainly like to know. For instance, South Dakota is the only state in the union that does not prohibit gifts from lobbyists to politicians, okay? Every other state does. So how is it unconstitutional for South Dakota to join the other 49 states?
But there must be some things in there that are obvious.
Yeah.
So, could someone speak to what it is?
Does anybody know?
Yeah.
What is the basis of the injunction?
Here you go.
So the injunction was based on the judge saw
public funding.
Exactly, public funding
through appropriation.
Yep, requires a 2/3 vote to appropriate funds from the legislature. So that's one thing that they were talking about. Another thing with the ethics commission, they were saying that it falls outside of the three branches of government.
Yeah, it creates another branch.
It creates another branch, which we also have to go through the Constitution. But the interesting thing about the injunction, when Judge Barnett put that out there, is he listed off these issues, but at the same time, he also listed off what the legislature would have to do to make IM-22 work from his perspective. So when the legislature is talking repeal and replace about all these things, really, they do have a blueprint in front of them of how to make IM-22 work that they are willingly choosing not to follow.
Is there a place online to read the judge's injunction and language?
Yeah, I believe so. It should be made public record.
Legislative council.
Yeah, it's
the legislative council would have it. The legislative research council. I mean, I'm throwing a lot of traffic your way, but I first read through the breakdown of it on DakotaFreePress.com.
I've got a copy online. I can email it to you. Mm-hmm. It is a public document. I don't think it's on LRC yet because the court system doesn't put its document. You can go to the courthouse and see it on a computer there, but you can't download it on the internet. But there are PDFs out there one can read.
Mm-hmm. We do a lot of local activism and open government, dealing with municipalities and the counties and so on. And you know, the local area, you know, the local political offices are kind of a breeding ground of how do you ethically do things. Mm-hmm. We have public officials here in Sioux Falls who have admitted that they and their family have invested in special deals with developers and contractors. We wanted to know if IM-22 comes down to the municipal level to cover the what we consider illegal activities on ethical activities of our local officials.
Well, I'll
reference one more thing. We get an excuse constantly in Sioux Falls that we're home rule charter, so our political officers in the city don't have to follow state ethics laws, etc.
Well, it is a statewide, so.
But does it specifically bring in municipalities?
Yeah. No. But
counties, townships, municipalities.
What's that?
No. Counties, townships, municipalities, no.
Okay.
But the interesting thing is that we're the first state to pass something along the lines of IM-22, a comprehensive anti-corruption reform package. But a lot of municipalities elsewhere in the country have been passing similar provisions using the same sort of reasoning and logic behind what IM 22 was. And the great thing about the municipal initiative and referendum is that when the voters pass something at the municipal level, the city council or whatever is in charge can't touch it for a year after it goes into, after it's passed by the voters. So it would be something that would be nice to see at the city level too, and is very much designed to be implemented at the city level.
I hate to wrap it up, but we're past one, and two speakers will stay around for a little while.
Yeah.
We'll stick around for anybody who wants to talk, have any questions, whatever.
I'd like to say, if everybody in this room wrote a letter to the governor and to the person who represents you in fear, it'd get quite a bit. It'd only cost you 47 cents, and it would be a bargain. Let's do it, everybody that's in this room.
Could you put your cookies down, please? Security, escort this gentleman out, please.
Come on, Soda Pop, let's go.